Hi there, I'm Andrew Bunnell, and today let's look at the 555 circuit. Right behind me is a picture of the 555 circuit. You'll need to take a screenshot of the picture in Tinkercad and submit it on Moodle as part of the pre-lab. Let's take a look how to do that. Well, first off, you have to log into Tinkercad, and so here I'm logged into Tinkercad. When you first log in, it'll probably look like this. You're going to go up here and hit search and type in 555 and Fizz 142. And log in, and I forgot to click on circuits, and so here we go, circuits, and you're going to click on this one right here, the 555 Fizz 142, or you know what, you could actually click on a copy of the single simple circuit as well. I'm going to go ahead and hit copy and tinker, and now this copies one, this copies a version over to your own desk or over to your own account, and to move it around, you can just hold the left mouse button and you can move this circuit around, and then to make it bigger or smaller you can use the mouse wheel. Alright, there's a bunch of cool electrical components over here, including some programmable stuff, but please don't add anything to this circuit until after you've completed the experiment. Adding something like one of these components may make your simulation not run in real time, so let's just go ahead and hide that. Alright, so the first thing you want to do is you want to test out each component. You want to verify that each component is the correct value. And to do that, you click on each component, and notice I just dragged those two little things out of the way just a little bit so that I can click on that little brown resistor. And you see the resistance says 20 kilo ohms. And let's go ahead and click on the next one. And that one as well, it should be 20 kilo ohms. This large black cylinder is a capacitor. And you click on that and it should say 100 microfarads. And each of these blue capacitors down here should each be 10 microfarads. So I'm just going to click on one at a time. Yep, there's 10, that's 10, that's 10. And they're all 10 microfarads. Okay, I've just set up my screen just slightly different. First I made the circuit just a little bit smaller, and then I've also added in a second window up here up top that is just a Google stopwatch. You can also use a cell phone timer, but I actually find it a little bit fumbly to use my finger on the timer, especially my start and stop buttons are in different locations. So here I can just click the same spot and then click it again. So I'm going to go ahead and hit start simulation, and the LED turns red. You can't use the first on time, but go ahead and click it again when it turns on, and then click it again a second time when it turns off. Now this 3.98 seconds, I was a little bit slow on the first one and a little bit right on the second one, but that's okay. Measurement doesn't have to be perfect. And I'll show you, I'll do it again. And here we go. There was the on time. And then when it turns on again, and this time it's 4.19 seconds. And that's actually closer to the true value. And you're going to take 10 measurements so that you can get a good handle on what your uncertainty of your timing is. Okay, so I just finished typing all my data into Excel. And here are the periods that I measured with my cell phone. I actually took another set with the Google app, and I'll show you what the differences, how they compare. At the end. So first off, we need to find the average of these set of measurements, and to find that you can just type in average and then put a parenthesis and then select the data. So I'm going to select that bottom one all the way to the top and hit enter. And there's the average of that set of data that I took. Next, for standard deviation, STDEV. And you notice there's a lot of options. You can either do STDEV or STDEV.S. In physics, we're assuming we're always taking a sample of the entire population, not the entire population. And so I'll use stdev.s and select the data, and there's my standard deviation. Now, I've already had it rounded. It should look like that when you first do it. Now, the next thing to find the standard error, you simply take the standard deviation and divide it by the square root of the count. And in this case, I have 10 values, so I could have just divided by the square root of 10, and there we go. And once again, I've already rounded it, so it would have had more digits. To round these, you have to round that because it's a rule one and two to two digits, and this one is not a one or two for the most significant digit, so I'm just rounding it to one digit. Okay, now just slightly down below, I have two more spots for formulas, and the expected value is the ln of 2, the natural log of 2, times it by the first resistor, which was 20,000, plus 2 times the second resistor, 20,000, times the capacitance. And for the first set of data, the capacitor was fixed, and so that was just 0.0001. And so my expected time was actually 4.159. And so let's find out what my z-score is. And I'm going to go ahead and type in ABS for absolute value, just in case I put the first one wrong, which I did in this case. See, this one's smaller than this one. And now put a parenthesis divided by my standard error and hit enter. And so I got a z-score of 4.5. Now, like I said, this set of data I actually did take with my cell phone, and I was fumbling a little bit. I didn't take that good of data. I could claim that the applet was running, or the simulation was running slow, but there's a good chance that I just was running slow because I took this data first thing in the morning and the coffee hadn't kicked in yet. All right. Okay, so the next thing is we got to copy the data into this worksheet. And so to do that, we got to come back up here, select the data, Control C, and value paste. Now in Windows, it's this 123, and then, and also in Mac, it's control click, and then paste special values. And then to get the 123 down, you can just type in a 1 and then a 2 and highlight them both, and then just drag the corner down, and that will fill up those. To start out, let's just go ahead and we could fit it with this, but it also tells us just to use the standard deviation of the residuals, Control C, and value paste that right here. And there we go. Now we come over here and we'll fit the line. And I already put the two check boxes there because we're just fitting a flat line. And like the instructions say, we don't typically fit a flat line to data. This is just so that we can see what an average and standard deviation look like. And so here's my chart right there. And down here, here's my residual plot. The residuals are random and scattered. The mean right here is almost zero. This is actually a Microsoft rounding error right here. And then 2/3 of my data fall within plus and minus 1 sigma of the average of the residuals. And if you notice, there's 3 points that are outside, and then there's 7 points inside. That's roughly 2/3. And then we come over here and we'll round these digits using a rule of 1 and 2. So let's go ahead and do that using those same buttons up there. It's a 1 and 2 there. And then I've already typed in that. And for this experiment, you don't actually have to type this in because we already did it on the other sheet. And you're going to compare the standard error, you're going to compare the standard deviation, and even the mean with the other data. Now in the second part of the experiment, you're going to actually vary the capacitance. And to do so, you're going to go ahead and hit stop simulation. And you're going to drag one capacitor, one little blue capacitor at a time, in between that red and blue line. And now each little blue capacitor is 10 microfarads, and the big one's 100 microfarads. And when you add them in between these two lines, it's adding in parallel, and that becomes 110. And this would be 120 microfarads, 130, etc., all the way up to 190 microfarads. And so let's go ahead to show you. And drag each one, but you want to kind of have them close together. Oops, didn't mean to drag that. So that they all fit in between these two bars. And obviously you're going to start the simulation each time. You're going to start the simulation each time and then take a measurement and then stop the simulation. But I'm going to go ahead and hit start simulation for this last one and try to get a good measurement so you know what a good range of values are. So 100 microfarads should give about 4.16 seconds, and then this one should give a little bit over 8 seconds. Let's see if I can do it. Sorry, I started too quick. I stopped it too quick. Let's try it a second time and go. 8 seconds. See, I was a little bit fast there. Once again, it should be just a little bit over 8 seconds. Now for the next part of the experiment, you're going to make a copy of this. So you'd right click, move or copy, and you put a checkbox. Now on Mac, you're going to control click the tab, or if you have a mouse, that's the right click is the control click. And then you're going to go ahead and create a copy, and then you're going to rename it by control clicking again or right clicking, and then you're going to rename it. I've already made a copy of the tab and renamed it to changing the capacitor and put in my data. So once again, we started at 100 microfarads and we went all the way to 190 microfarads by adding in those little blue resistors one at a time. And each time that happened, I measured the period and then I just typed in those numbers. And then before you fit your data, you should go over and take a look at your data. And it doesn't really matter having those things checked or not for right now. We're really going to be just doing a slope for this one, not an intercept and not a quadratic term. And I come down and look at my data and I can see, wait a second, this point right here is out of place. And then lo and behold, I went back to my data and I actually had a typo as I was typing them in. This wasn't 7.72. I actually wrote down 6.72. And so let's fix that. Let's go back over and take a look at the data. And that looks much better. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and hit perform regression. And I'm going to compare the standard deviation residuals for the second set to my first set. And look, lo and behold, they're almost the same. 0.062 and 0.068. Go ahead and control C. It means I did just slightly better when the periods varied. And I'm going to go ahead and paste that in. And I could probably claim the coffee was starting to kick in. Anyways, let's go over and take a look at the data. And I'm going to scroll down. Now in this time, the expected Z is going to be the LN of 2 times, this is really 20,000 plus 2 times 20,000 for the second resistor. And I get an expected Z of 41,588. And it has weird units, and the units aren't that important for this experiment. This is just to show a proportionality constant as we change Z, or as we change the capacitance. And it looks pretty close, but my standard error is kind of high, and so I'm still not very close. I guess maybe the coffee hadn't kicked in yet, or, you know, it's likely that my cell phone was a little bit fumbly. Now here we'd round these numbers. Now typically, because it's a rule of 1 and 2, we would round it to 130, but Microsoft will only let you round it to there. So here we'd round it to 130 and 42,080. Or you could write it in scientific notation, which is probably preferred. Okay, like I said, spoiler alert, I took a second set of data using the mouse and the Google Timing applet instead of my cell phone. And when we take a look at this, here's my next set of periods, and there's my average, standard deviation, standard error, and there's my expected, and lo and behold, my z-score is far better than it was before. Let me just double check I grabbed the right cells. Yep, my z-score was far better than before. And then I took another set of period data and went over here and plotted it and fit it, and then copied over my standard deviation of the residuals and came over here. And once again, well, this time I didn't do quite as well, but I didn't do quite as bad as I did before. And so that's what the data processing looks like in Excel. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching.